good to be together here in this space. God's Spirit is here in and among and with us as we gather for worship. In your bulletin, you'll see opportunities for worship, for discipleship, and for service here at Francis Asbury United Methodist Church. Coming up after worship today, our nominations and like leadership committee will meet. That will be in the fellowship hall, so thank you to those who serve in that way. Thank you for the gift of your presence today. You'll see in the bulletin today, tomorrow is the deadline for our next month's newsletter, and we want to extend gratitude to those who were part of our pantry and food market this week. We had, 108 individuals that were served, and that might be the highest threshold so far since we've been offering this ministry to our community. So we're grateful for the opportunity to serve our neighbors, to partner with MANA, and to do this each and every month. If you went through the Findlay room today, you might have noticed there's a few clipboards over there and some opportunities for you to sign up for, for Bible study, for family fun and putt-putt. And then we are gearing up for back to school. Next Sunday is back to school Sunday. And so if you are a student, we invite you to bring your backpack to church with you. We're going to have a special time of blessing and praying over your backpack and over you as you get ready to start a new school year. We also want to pray for families and for staff and teachers as you get ready to start a new school year. And so one of the ways we're going to do that is we're having a prayer vigil for Monday the 28th, which is the first day of school. So from 7:30 in the morning till 3:30 in the afternoon, we have time slots so that in every moment of the day, someone from our church is praying for you, for students and for staff and for families as you start the first day of school. So we still have some time slots available, so we invite you to just take 15 minutes to carve out of that day to be in prayer for the first day of school. You can do that here in the sanctuary, or you can do that from wherever you are, carving out that time in that space. So after our worship next week, we're going to head to the pool for a hot dog lunch and for some fun and fellowship and swimming. So that information's in your bulletin about the time and the address. But if you have any questions, let us know. Everyone is invited for lunch and for fellowship and fun time together. One of the other clipboards that is over there, I'm trying to keep track of all the clipboards that are over there, is for volunteering with Children's Church. This is such an important ministry to our young disciples. So next Sunday, Children's Church will return. That's when our young disciples, after their special time in worship, they leave and they have a special time that is just for them. So we're going to have some volunteers that are lined up. And so we have a schedule over here for you to sign up and to serve in that way with our very special young disciples. There's a few other items you can mark for your calendar for ongoing service here. But we're so grateful for the ways that you share your time and your talents and your prayers and your presence and your gifts here, not just in this space, but in our community. Now I'll invite you to join me in our call to worship. Come, let us celebrate the forgiving, reconciling love of God.
Once we were lost, led us so far away. Now we've been found and known.
Know that God's love is lavished upon you forever. Come, let us celebrate and praise the God of love.
Please stand as you're able and join in singing freely, freely.
Thank you. passage today of 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 16 through 21. Let's open our hearts and minds to receive this message from God. From now on, therefore, we regard no one from a human point of view. Even though we once knew Christ from a human point of view, we know him no longer in that way. So if anyone is in Christ, there is a new creation. Everything old has passed away. See, everything has become new. All this is from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and has given us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, in Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them, and entrusting the message of reconciliation to us. So we are ambassadors for Christ, since God is making his appeal through us. We entreat you on behalf of Christ to be reconciled to God. For our sake, he made him to be sin who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. Thanks be to God.
Jesus said, "Let the children come to me and do not hinder them, for to such as these belongs the kingdom of heaven." Remember those words of Jesus and invite all of our young disciples to come down for a time of sharing with Jesus.
Love is something if you give it away, give it away, give it away. Love is something if you give it away, you end up having more. It's just like a magic penny. You put it in your pocket and then you end up having more. Good morning, young disciples. It is so good to see you this morning. I'm going to need your help today. You think you might be able to help me at the end of our disciples moment time? Okay, this is what I'm going to need you to do. I'm really in a mood for singing this morning. I'm not all that good at it, but I love to do it. And so at the end, we're going to sing a song together, and we're going to need some hand motions. And I want all the disciples in this building to help us with these. So when we say so high, we're going to put our arms up. Can you do that? Practice with me. Excellent. So low. Reach down low. So wide. Spread your arms out. Oh, good. I suggest behind the pianos practicing the best for me. Excellent. And before I start, I need to show these friends out here because I'll be facing you and they might not be able to see. Jane knows who these are. This is my friend Hugs.
And Socks.
And Flops. And Butterscotch. And they're going to help me tell the story this morning. There's a lady, whom I also have two pennies, and I have a picture of some pigs. Okay. In case you can't see, because I'm down low. There's a lady named Sue Bleaser, and she put our Bible story to song. We've been talking about the same story for 3 weeks, about a father and two sons. And we've learned from Miss Nanya that when we make unwise choices and turn back to God, God loves us. And we learned from Pastor Avery last week, that sometimes when we feel, that's not fair, what about me? God comes to us and offers us love then too. Jess, could I have a note A on the piano? I think that's about where I should start. Thank you. Hugs is the father. Flops. Butterscotch are the sons. Well, this is a story about the father and two sons, and it begins talking about the brothers. There once were two brothers, and one of them got greedy, greedy brothers. Two brothers, and one of them got greedy, greedy. He said, "Dad, I want my money, money." It's a story of a father and two sons. The other older brother stayed on the farm to worky, worky. Other older brother stayed on the farm to worky, worky. Greedy one spent all that money, money. It's a story of a father and two sons. He spent it on having fun and drinking drink. He spent it, on having fun and drinking drinkies. He spent every shiny penny penny. It's a story of a father and two sons. The money was finished, and so he fed the piggy piggies. The money was finished, and so he fed the piggy piggies. He was broke and kind of stinky, stinky. It's a story of a father and two sons. He went home to daddy to say, I'm really sorry, sorry. He went home to daddy to say, I'm really sorry, sorry. Dad said, son, let's throw a party, party. It's a story of a father and two sons. The son who stayed home was feeling kind of grumpy, grumpy. The older brother who stayed home was feeling kind of grumpy, grumpy. He said, Dad, you must be crazy, crazy. It's a story of a father and two sons. Dad said to Sonny, we're gonna have a party, party. Dad said to Sonny, come on in to the party, party. My son was lost, but now he's found, he found it. It's a story of a father and two sons. Thank you for listening to all of that. I know that was kind of silly. So, I wonder why Jesus told this story. You know, in this story, if we think about it, the father didn't have to give that money to the son. It wasn't time for him to have it. He didn't have to give it to him, but he did. And when the son wasted all that money and came back, he didn't have to forgive him and have a big party, make a big deal over him. And during that party, they were all celebrating. The other son was out there being grumpy. The father left all his friends in the big party and he went out and told that son, come on in and have a good time with us. And the son felt like, I don't want to. What about me? And the father said, oh, you're with me all the time, and everything I have is yours. I wonder if Jesus wants us to know that God is like that Father. Maybe God loves us all the time, and we need to come back and say, I'm sorry, and we're feeling like life isn't fair, this isn't going well for me. Maybe God even invites us to love Him even during those times. I think that God's love is so big that He'll never run out of love for each and every one of us. And that is great news for today. So there's a song. We already practiced some hand motions, and I need everyone's help, and I need your voices. I'm going to sing a line, and then everybody else will sing the line back. I might help you, so it's not just a dead silence. And I need your hand motions. God's love is so wonderful. Your turn. God's love is so wonderful. God's love is so wonderful.
God's love is so wonderful.
God's love is so wonderful.
God's love is so wonderful.
God's wonderful love.
God's wonderful love.
So high,
it's so high.
Can't get over it,
can't get over it.
So low,
it's so low.
You can't get under it,
can't get under it.
So wide,
so wide.
You can't get around it,
can't get around it.
God's wonderful love,
God's wonderful love.
Let's pray. Lord, thank you for your wonderful love that never ends. Thank you for presenting Jesus and his stories would help us to come to know you better. And we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you. You can go back to your seats.
Please stand and join us singing In Christ Alone.
Holy and gracious God, we gather for worship today to be in your presence, our prodigal God, our loving parent. You have created us, called us, claimed us, redeemed us, and commissioned us. We worship you today with all that we are. Gathering together in person and in spirit, it strengthens us for service, and so we are glad to be here today. You are the God of the lost, of the least, and of all who long for home. When we wander from your ways and waste the gifts you have given us, you welcome us back. You celebrate and rejoice. God, you know the deepest places of our hearts. Forgive us when we doubt your mercy, when we foolishly believe that we must earn it of our own accord, when we attempt to judge the worthiness of others. Lord, let this be a welcoming place, a place of return and homecoming, a place built by love. For For it is your love that has been waiting like a candle in the window, ever lighting the way back, and never willing to let go of hope that every child will return home. Let this be a place where the only appropriate response to love that has come home is to roast the fatted calf, hold a feast and celebrate, to send up balloons, to sing a song, and to prepare a party for that that was lost and has returned once more. As you have welcomed us, so we are to welcome others. As we continue on our journey, we want to be like the Father in the parable, and we want to be more like you. As we pray together, we lift up prayers of thanksgiving, grateful for your good gifts and for your blessings. They are great and small, and we always want to be mindful of them. As we pray together, we lift up prayers of concern and of intercession. We lift up all of your children who long for home, who seek forgiveness and who are struggling to forgive themselves. We lift up your children who are sick in mind, or body, or spirit. Your children who give themselves fully in the service of others. Your children who wish they could lay down their heavy burdens, and your children who work for peace. We lift up your children who have suffered the catastrophic effects of war and violence and fire and disaster. Lord, we pray that you will enter such places, that you will enter hearts and souls, and with your spirit of comfort and peace, bring healing and mercy. Equip us to be your hands and your feet, to reflect your light into dark places and your hope into despairing and longing neighbors. We pray, as we always do, in the name of Christ, who is our Lord, and we join our voices together in the prayer that he has taught us to pray, saying, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread,
and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
As we continue in worship, one of our acts of worship is to give our gifts, our tithes and our offerings, which is returning to God a portion of what God has first gifted and trusted to our care. Thank you for your generosity and faithfulness, the ways that you give of your gifts that don't just stay here, but they flow out beyond us to neighbors, to communities, to partner organizations, and to create future disciples. We'll give our gifts today by passing the offering plates up and down the pews, and we always have the opportunity to give our gifts online through our church website and at the back of the sanctuary where there is a wooden box for that purpose. We'll invite the ushers to come.
Thank you.
Almighty God, we ask your blessing upon these gifts. May they go into the world to reflect your wonderful, amazing love. May they serve you by serving your neighbors. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, we pray, and God's people say,
Amen.
You may be seated.
Heaven and before you, I am no longer worthy to be called your son.
treat me like one of your hired hands. So he set off and went to his father. But while he was still far off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion. He ran and put his arms around him and kissed him. Then the son said to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. But the father said to his slaves, Quickly, bring out a robe, the best one, and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet, and get the fatted calf and kill it, and let us eat and celebrate. For this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. And they began to celebrate. Now his elder son was in the field, and when he came and approached the house, he heard music and dancing. He called one of the slaves and asked what was going on. He replied, Your brother has come, and your father has killed the fatted calf because he has got him back safe and sound. Then he became angry and refused to go in. His father came out and began to plead with him. But he answered his father, Listen, for all these years I have been working like a slave for you, and I have never disobeyed your command. Yet you have never given me even a young goat so that I might celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours comes back, who has devoured your property with prostitutes, you killed the fatted calf for him? Then the father said to him, Son, you are always with me, and all that is mine is yours. But we had to celebrate and rejoice because this brother of yours was dead and has come to life. He was lost and has been found. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
One day, a man was trying to do his regular grocery shopping, but he was clearly distracted, and he was sort of disrupting all the other customers in the store as well. He had his cart full of groceries, and in the seat of the cart was a screaming baby. As he went up and down each aisle, the baby kept screaming, and the man kept repeating softly, Keep calm, George. Don't get excited, George. Don't yell, George. A woman noticed this, and so she went up to the man with the full cart and the screaming baby, and she said, Oh, you are to be just applauded. You have such good patience in trying to quiet little George here. He looked at her and said, Lady, I'm George. Parenting is not an easy job. It might be the most difficult job that there is. There's no manual that says, here's how to do it. Here's how to be a parent. Here's how to care for and raise a healthy and kind and responsible and well-adjusted child. We do the best we can. The father in Jesus' parable didn't have a parenting 101 book that had a chapter on, here's what you do when your adult child comes to you and says, Hey, Dad, I don't want to wait any longer for you to die. Give me my inheritance now. Where is that chapter? For the last 2 weeks, we have considered both of that man's sons. Not by name. We know them as the older son and the younger son. As he told the parable, Jesus did not give them names, probably on purpose. And that helps us to see ourselves in them. We have seen ourselves in that youngest son, a little bit wayward, a little bit impatient, impulsive, or greedy, humbled, or repentant. We've seen ourselves a little bit in the oldest son, responsible, dependable, rule-following, maybe a little bit self-doubting, or indignant, or resentful, or bitter, or questioning, or competitive. For the last 2 weeks, we've also considered that famous painting of Rembrandt, The Return of the Prodigal Son. It's believed that Rembrandt painted this piece at the end of his life, sometime between 1665 and 1667. Now, when he was a young man, Rembrandt was known for being a little bit arrogant, a little bit argumentative. He was successful and popular and wealthy. But as his life progressed, he experienced devastating loss. His first wife died. Then his son died. Then two of his daughters died. Then the woman that he was living with succumbed to mental illness. Then his second wife died. He lost all of his money, his popularity, his success faded away. And his art changed at this point in his life. Art historians can look at it and they can tell. The experts say he wouldn't have painted this painting as a young man. Not as a young and successful artist. This would not have come from his paintbrush. Maybe he wasn't mature enough. Maybe he lacked some understanding. It's said that this is one of the most intimate paintings that he ever created. It is a portrait of appearance mercy. And he only painted it after the loss and after the suffering. When Vincent van Gogh saw this painting, he said, "You can only paint this painting when you have died many deaths." It was at that point in his life that Rembrandt knew what it was to return to God's mercy. And so he painted it. He knew what it was to come home. One writer said about Rembrandt, "One must have died many deaths and cried many tears to have painted a portrait of God in such humility." Today, we have come back to Jesus' parable one more time. And this time, we focus on that third character, on the Father. He is the protagonist. He is the main character. He is the one from whom we learn. Jesus told many parables, and he was often saying things like, "Well, the kingdom of God is like this." He told the parables to help us learn about God, about God's nature, and about God's kingdom. He would say, "Well, the kingdom of God is like a mustard seed. The kingdom of God is like a sower who went out and scattered seed, and some of it fell on the path, and some of it fell on rocky soil, and some of it fell on thorns, and some of it fell on good soil." The kingdom of God is like a merchant who was looking for fine pearls, and when he found one of great value, he went out and he sold everything that he had, and he bought that pearl. In this parable, in Luke 15, it is the character of the Father through which Jesus does this. He tells us, this is what God is like. God is like a parent whose arms are open, who offers abundant grace and unconditional love to his children. When we read the parable, it's interesting that the father didn't say no when the younger son made that request, even though it was heartbreaking. Even though it was humiliating, he made this demand and then he left. He went off to a distant land. Now the younger son's inheritance, it wasn't sitting in the family safety deposit box. It wasn't in an investment account. It was literally part of the estate that the father owned. So to divide up an estate means you put out a for sale sign and you sell part of it. And the neighbors wouldn't notice that. They would have gossiped, and they would have asked questions, and they would have observed, this is a great break in tradition. This is insulting to your family. This just isn't done. But the father doesn't say any of that. What does he do when his younger son makes this request? He lets him go. He doesn't force him to stay home. The son has free will, his choice. He has freedom. He can go. And it's love that lets him go. It's love that lets him find his own life, even though it comes with risks. So I wonder, as I hear this parable, as I look at this painting and see those hands, were they always stretched out? Even when there was no one there to set them upon, were they always stretched out like that? What if this is Aaron who has never pulled them back. When Henry Nouwen looked at this painting, he realized this. He said, I am loved so much that I'm left free to leave home. The blessing is there from the beginning. I have left it and I keep on leaving it. But the Father is always looking for me with those outstretched arms to receive me back and to whisper in my ear, you are my beloved. On you, my favor rests. Those same arms were open to the older son as well. For all those years that he stayed home, that he worked on the estate, that he did what he thought was expected of him, and maybe he didn't notice those open arms. They were open on the night of the great feast when all the neighbors were there, the same ones that had whispered about the for sale sign, the ones that had wondered what happened to that young man, the one that they watched grow up and then he left and they didn't see him anymore. They were all invited to the party. The fatted calf was cooked and was on the table and the wine had been poured and the music was playing and the youngest brother was there with the world and his ring and brand new sandals on his feet, and his older brother was waiting outside the door. And so the father, the host of the evening, takes leave from his guests, and he goes outside the house, and there he opens his arms again. Again, this child has had freedom. He's had choice. And again, he's had love, the love that is given generously and freely without expectation or quid pro quo. Why does this father love his children? Is it because they're good? Is it because they're responsible? Because they're obedient? Because they're successful? Because they deserve it? No. But the sons have been tempted into thinking that's how it works. They have both looked for love in the wrong places. Now, not all parents are able to live into that role in a healthy and responsible way. We know that. We've seen it happen. But when a parent is, when the love that they have for their children is expressed unconditionally like this, then that love is a conditional. Parents love their children because they're your children. Not because they've earned it, because they've checked any boxes. It's unwavering, and no amount of mistakes or disappointments can diminish it. C.S. Lewis once wrote, the Christian does not think God will love us because we're good, but that God will make us good because God loves us. The best way we have to think about God's love for us, the best way we can understand it is to consider that idea of a most loving God. And so maybe that's why Jesus tells the parable the way that he does. The scribes and the Pharisees were muddling and complaining, and they were grumpy. This man, he welcomes sinners, and he eats with them. And so Jesus teaches them something about God and about God's nature. And he says, once there was a man who had two sons. Once there was in the Methodist Church, we talk a lot about grace. We talk about different kinds of grace, and one of those is prevenient, the grace that comes before. That's the grace that means it wasn't you that chose God, but it was God that first chose you. Before you were born, before any human person decided anything about you or laid any claim to you, God knew you. God laid claim to you. The scriptures tell us God knit you together in your mother's womb. God was the first one to love you with this all-powerful, unconditional love. The grace of God has come before you knew it and before you claim it. This parable in Luke 15, it reminds me of another parable that Jesus tells about another landowner and about the employees that he hires for a day. It'll be one of the parables that we talk about later this fall as we talk about some of Jesus' parables. But there was this same kind of jealousy and resentment between the workers, the ones that were hired early in the day and the ones that were hired later in the day, even though they all received what was promised from the landowner. The workers who had started earlier in the day said, "Wait a minute, this isn't fair." And the landowner says, "Hey, you received exactly what was promised. You haven't gone without. I hear the father there saying, all I have is yours. My generosity to another doesn't take away from you. I'm generous, and so I hoped that you could rejoice on behalf of somebody else. I hoped you could rejoice on behalf of somebody else." Once there was a man who coached a little league team of 8-year-olds. And so on this team, he had quite a few really excellent players. Then he had someone fell in the middle. Then he had a few kids that just hadn't quite got the hang of baseball yet. They didn't win one game all season. And so in the last inning of the last game their team played, they were down by one run. And there were two outs. And the player who was up to bat hadn't been able to hit the baseball or catch the baseball all season long. So he surprised everybody, including himself, when he got hit. And he ran to first base and he was just grinning from ear to ear. So the next batter up was one of the team's real sluggers. And so people started getting their hopes up. Maybe we'll get our first win of the season. So he hit the ball in the air. And he ran to first base, and that kid who'd gotten his first hit of the season started running to second base, but he looked up, and there was that baseball in the air coming towards him. And so he reached up, and he caught it. It was the final out of the game. They had lost. And so the coach looks over at the dugout, and he tells the team to run out and to congratulate their teammate that had caught the ball in between first and second. And so they did, and that kid was just beaming. He never realized that he had contributed to the third out of the game. He just knew that for the first time he had hit the ball, and he had caught the ball, and his teammates were cheering for him. They were rejoicing on behalf of somebody else. Henry Nouwen says in his book, The Return of the Prodigal Son, he says, "Here lies hidden the great call to conversion. To not look with the eyes of my own low self-esteem, but with the eyes of God's love. As long as I keep looking at God as a landowner, as a father who wants to get the most out of me for the least cost, then I can't help but become jealous and bitter and resentful towards all my fellow workers, my brothers and my sisters. But if I can look at the world with the eyes of God's love and I discover God is not a typical landowner or a patriarch, but God is this all-giving and forgiving father who doesn't measure out love to his children according to how well they behave. And I see my only true response is gratitude. The father who comes to his children with his open arms can't wait to embrace them, to give them new life and an abundant life. He can't wait to give them forgiveness and intimacy and celebration. You know, celebration is an important part of God's kingdom. There's joy, Jesus says, in recovering what's been lost. There's joy in God's kingdom. There's joy in the body of Christ. Won't you share in this joy, he asks. The call to return, the call to be embraced by those arms is the call to let them also be ours. A well-known preacher, Dr. Wong, talks about a story he heard one time, and it was a young woman who was remembering her own father. She said when she was young, she and her father were so close, and the time that they would kind of experience the most closest when they have a family reunion, and the aunts and the uncles and the cousins would be there, and there'd be food and music, and she said, at some point, somebody would pull out this old record player, and they'd put on polka music. And eventually, somebody would put on the Beer Barrel Polka. And people would be dancing, but when that song came on, Her father would come up to her and he would tap her on the shoulder and he would say, "I believe this is our dance." And they would dance. One time, though, at a family reunion, she was a teenager. She's in one of those teenage moods. And the Beer Barrel Polka started to play at the family reunion, and her father came up and he tapped her on the shoulder and he said, "I believe this is our dance." And she snapped at him, "Get away from me. Leave me alone. I don't want to dance." And so he turned away and he didn't ask anymore. Our relationship became difficult through all those teenage and young adult years, she said. When I'd come home late, I miss curfew. My father would be sitting there in his chair and he'd be asleep wearing an old bathrobe and I would just snarl at him, "What do you think you're doing?" And he would look at me with really sad eyes and he would say, "I was just waiting on you." She said, "I went off to college and I was pretty glad to get out of the house and kind of get away from my folks. And for all these years, I never communicated with him. But as I got older, I started to miss that. And one day I decided the next time there was a family reunion, I was going to go. And while I was there, somebody put on the Beer Barrel Polka. And so I took a deep breath and went over to my father and I tapped him on the shoulder and said, "I believe this is our dance." And he turned around and looked at me and said, "I've been waiting on you." Isn't that what the Father embodies in this parable? Isn't that like God, whom Jesus called Abba, Father? Dr. Long says, standing at the center of our life is God, who says to us, "Everything I have is yours. All that I am is for you, and I am waiting on you." For 3 weeks now, we've studied this parable that Jesus told about a father and his two sons. And maybe along the way you found yourself in that story somewhere. Maybe you've been a prodigal who left home for a little while and came back. Maybe you've been a prodigal sibling. Maybe you've been a prodigal parent. Maybe you've been all three. Maybe you are someone who is seeking those arms, those outstretched arms of a prodigal God. But no matter where you find yourself, and no matter where your family members or your pew mates or your neighbors or your friends find themselves in this story of Jesus, we all have one thing in common. We are all children of the prodigal God. The one who says, "We have to celebrate because my child was dead and is alive. My child was lost and now is found." This is the one who says, "I've been waiting for you. Welcome home." Thanks be to God.
Please stand if you're able and join us singing verses 1, 2, and 5. "Since Jesus came into my heart."
Thank you.
our service of worship ends, our worship through service begins. Go forth now in the grace and the peace and the love of the one who has wrapped their arms around you.